Due to the unfortunate, racist, envious, and ignorant nature of this old newspaper article, there's gonna be corrections and, commentary made along the way. So, top right-hand corner illustration. It reads, Abyssinians worship in this tent on the roof of the Holy Sepulchre. Correctly, it should read, Ethiopian Hebrews worship in this tent. Now, center image, it reads, Haile Selassie reached Palestine yesterday on his way to seek sanctuary with the Abyssinian community in Jerusalem. Correctly, it should read, His Imperial Majesty, the first Haile Selassie, King of Kings, elect of God, conquering lion of the tribe of Judah, Emperor of Ethiopia, reached Palestine yesterday on his pilgrimage to the Ethiopian Hebrew community in Jerusalem. Sanctuary for the Lion of Judah by H.V. Morton. It must be noted that the emperor did not really seek sanctuary. He made a pilgrimage, being that the emperor himself owns property in Jerusalem. So it's all, it's coming from racism, envy, and ignorance. The defeated emperor of Abyssinia is seeking a temporary refuge among the Abyssinian community in Jerusalem. Correctly, it should read, The Lion of Judah prevailed of Ethiopia is making a short pilgrimage to the Ethiopian Hebrew community in Jerusalem. This term conveys the wrong impression to average people. A community in a foreign city generally means a commercial community, with its own club, its own social life, and its own culture. Abyssinia's community, or the Ethiopian Hebrew community in Jerusalem, is not a commercial one. It is purely religious. It numbers about 300 black monks. 300 Ethiopian Hebrew black monks. When I was in Jerusalem recently gathering material for my book on the Holy Land, I was fascinated by these gentle, docile, poverty-stricken folk. Correction to be made. Fascinated by these Gentile-lessness and faithful and richfulness Ethiopian Hebrew black monks. And another way of interpreting this correctly is H.V. Morton is confronted with the painful truth, and he's describing his own reflection when he says he's a gentle, docile, easily led, easily made to believe, to make believe, and he's a folktale stricken with poverty. He's poor in spirit, poor in outlook, poor in character or lack thereof, poor in education, and so on and so forth. Their simplicity and their humility appealed to me almost as much as their ignorance astonished me. So, in this realization of truth, H.V. Morton is astonished by the ignorance that he himself possesses. When confronted with the expression clear simplicity, by the confrontation of being expressed great complexity through simplicity and still carrying themselves in such humility. So that is the appeal that H.V. Morton is making. He's appealing to the previous said. And his ignorance is astonishing to himself. And the humility being that he himself is boasting as if he was the all-knowing, all-powerful, you know? And so, continuing. But it was not the dreadful ignorance of the people who should know better. So, he's testifying that it's not the ignorance of the 300 Ethiopian Hebrew black monks, because they know better. It was the ignorance of a child, speaking of himself, and he is too kind in titling himself Little Child. The ignorance of a people in a state of arrest mental development. Once again, H.V. Morton is reflecting a description of himself. He's realizing with the confrontation of truth that his state of mind has been in a state of arrest. His ignorance testifies to this, and even throughout his education, whatever that might have been, his mental awareness has not developed. I felt when I got to know them that good qualities far outweigh the bad. So his confusion leads him to feel and not to acknowledge that the good qualities obviously far outweigh the bad. I also thought that if the founder of Christianity returned to Jerusalem, in this case, H.V. Morton is not testifying and is not going to declare who this founder of Christianity is, as if he knew not who he was, who he is, and who he is to be. But now he's declaring that if he were to return to Jerusalem, so obviously Morton knows that much about the founder of Christianity, and he would find more to admire. So now he's declaring that he knows him well enough, the founder of Christianity, to know what he would admire in the gentleness and poverty of the black monks of Abyssinia. Just pause right there, correction. In the Gentilelessness and in the richfulness of the 300 Ethiopian Hebrew black monks. Than in the pharisaical bickering and greedy jealousies of more enlightened Christians. Once again, the state of mind in which H.V. Morton is in a state of confusion leads him to make this fallacy in logic, this error in reasoning, by stating that Pharisee bickering, greediness, jealousies are of enlightened individuals, which is untrue. The only enlightened individuals in this case are the 300 Ethiopian Hebrew black monks. And as for the European Christians, not so enlightened, maybe obscured in darkness. In the course of Italy's gangster assault on this admittedly backward and possibly semi-barbaric race, H.V. Morton means to say that the Italians in this case, and maybe even the European Christians at this point, are admittedly backward and not possibly, but rather barbaric race. And not to offend and disrespect the Italians, for they themselves, because of ignorance, were manipulated to go along with the Vatican, the Pope of Rome scheme, along with Benito Mussolini and Victor Emmanuel. So, you know, they know not what they've done. Continuing, we have heard a lot about political complications and the tragedy of two members of an international organization engaged against the principles of the organization in war. Correction to be made, Ethiopia was not against anything, and Ethiopia did not set out in war or out of conflict. It was the Italian Vatican, Rome, allegiance, gangster assault on Ethiopia that led Ethiopia to simply defend themselves. But we have heard very little about the tragedy. True, correct. Which seems to me a very terrible one. Of a Christian nation deliberately attacking a weak Christian nation. And Ethiopia is not necessarily a Christian nation. It's Imperial Ethiopia was enlightened to the point where it is enlightening not to produce arms of mass destruction. And it is a backward, barbaric race that concludes to arm their nation with such military advances in science, so-called, or, you know, the backwardness of man through the use of arms. Continuing, the Abyssinians, or the Ethiopian Hebrews, unlike every other dark-skinned race in the world, not necessarily true, I might add, accepted the Christian faith centuries ago. They have a more ancient Christian tradition than many nations in Europe, probably than most. It is claimed that their conversion dates from the year AD 316, when Frumentus of Tyre, who was afterwards the first bishop of Alexandria, was shipwrecked on their shores. Well, I'll just add that the first baptism on documented is in the New Testament, the Bible, the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 8, where Philip baptizes the Ethiopian eunuch, but I have to add that other Ethiopians were baptized long before that. That just happens to be the first documented. I do not claim that their Christianity is of a very enlightened character. This statement comes out of H.P. Morton's Confusion and Denial, and Error in Reasoning, Fallacy in Logic. They are a almost unique instance of a semi-barbaric Christian people. He must be referring to the European Christian people or the Italian Christian people. But so strong is their sense of tradition that their religious observances are a museum for a student of religious history. So, once again, his confusion plays a role in this statement. He's declaring that the 300 Ethiopian Hebrew community is a museum to be learned from those learning in religious studies. So continuing, the next portion is missing due to the fact that this is an old newspaper clipping. So I'll continue. And have cloven feet. So it must have been speaking on the Levitical practices or law. They practice circumcision and dancing forms of their religious services. Among the Christian customs is the curious one of celebrating Christmas once a month. This must have to do with the Book of Numbers and the 12 gifts at the setting up of the tabernacle. They have also a number of remarkable saints, including Saint Pontius Pilate. In the course of their long barbaric religious services, they beat drums and shake Sisera, an instrument used in the temples of ancient Egypt to drive away evil spirits. This is true. The Sisera was used in Egypt, but keep in mind that Egypt was a colony of Ethiopia, so it makes sense. It's a fact. Another legacy of their contact with Palestine is in remote times is the belief that the royal family springs from a child of Solomon and Belkis. This is in fact true, although I am under the impression that it is Queen Makeda of Ethiopia. They say that Abyssinia or Ethiopia was the Sheba of the Old Testament. That is correct. And that their queen, Belkis, I would say Makeda, the infamous queen of Sheba, returning from her visit to the court of Solomon, brought back with her the Jewish faith. Or the Hebrew faith, more correctly. She bore a son to Solomon, who became Negus, or King Menelik, David the First of Ethiopia, a remote ancestor of the present emperor. They have always believed that the Lost Ark of the Covenant is buried somewhere in Abyssinia. Correctly, it would have to read buried somewhere in Ethiopia, but it's not buried. It's well known where it is. They're just not going to tell the heathen and the wicked. And obviously, it's an error in reasoning. It's not in Lost Ark. It's well known where it is. And it's not believed. It's a fact. It is with Ethiopia since long ago, since the days of Sheba and Solomon. Through Menelik, David the First of Ethiopia. The Abyssinian, or the Ethiopian Hebrew property in Jerusalem, consists of a round church outside the walls. And this is due to the fact that the Almighty Creator, that is good, Jah, Rastafari, asked the faithful to step out from the camp and to pitch the tent of the tabernacle outside the, you know, outside the camp, the city walls. A curious crail-like settlements on the banks of the Jordan, and a small church surrounded by a number of quailed huts on the roof of the Holy Sepulchre. Centuries ago, these black monks had a more privileged situation inside the church. celebrating elaborate masses every day in a chapel hardly bigger than a suburban sitting room. The text in between is missing. I apologize for that. To climb up to the roof of the Holy Sepulchre when the black monks are celebrating Mass is, I think, one of the most curious experiences in Jerusalem. It wasn't so curious in the days of Old Testament, being that the appearances of the Almighty Elohim, that is good, were oftentimes in what in Ethiopia are known as Amba Mountains or Flat Top Mountains, and in high places, as is testified in all the monasteries and holy land sites in Ethiopia, on high places in high mountains, on high mountains. So it's not that curious. In the glaring sun, our Lord had promised to his disciples, and finally the Feast of Tabor, the day on which his face was transfigured, and his disciples knew the glory of his divinity. These seven feasts are solemn according to the word dictated to the council as found in the Didascalia. The principal feast is Christmas. Some have said that the Feast of Incarnation is the principal feast, but we do not agree that the Incarnation is the main feast of our Lord. Praise be to God. The first of the feast of our Lord is the Annunciation made by God. May He be praised. Through the mouth of the angel Gabriel, who spoke to Our Lady, the Virgin Mary, Mother of God, our Redeemer, on the 29th day of Magabit. Observe, O brethren, the feast days, the primary one of which is the Feast of Christmas. Celebrate Christmas on the 25th day of the 9th month of the Jews, which corresponds to the 11th day of the 5th month of the Egyptians. On Christmas and baptism, Mass shall be celebrated at midnight, not to avoid fasting, but in honor of the feast. The Feast of Hosanna shall be celebrated. You, my brethren, acquired by the precious blood which is the blood of Jesus Christus, must celebrate the Feast of Easter with all care and great diligence after the Feast of Essenes. Do not celebrate this feast, which is the commemoration of the Passion of the Only Begotten Son, twice in a year, but only one time for the one who died for us one time. Beware of the Jewish feast at which Essenes are eaten, and which may take place in Niasai, and you shall not celebrate Easter until the 21st day of the month, so that it may not fall on the 14th day of the month, in a week other than it which Fesh is celebrated. Celebrate the Feast of the Resurrection of our Lord and Redeemer Jesus Christus only on a Sunday. You shall eat at cockcrow otherwise in the morning, and be vigilant during that night. Congregate in the church and pray by reading the Psalms, prophecies, and law. After the baptism of the catechumens, you shall read the gospel with fear and trembling, and shall deliver to the people speeches that are fit for their salvation. Offer the sacrifice which our Lord has commanded you through us by saying, "Do this in remembrance of me." After this, you shall break your fast with joy and cheerfulness, because our Lord Jesus Christus has risen from the dead and is the guarantee of our resurrection. This shall be a permanent law for you until the end of the world and the coming of our Lord. After 8 days, celebrate for yourselves a great feast, because on this day our Lord appeared to me, Thomas, when I refused to believe in his resurrection, and showed me the sign of the nails and the sign of the spear and the wound in his heart. You shall count 40 days from the first day of the week following Easter until the fifth Saturday, and then you shall celebrate the feast of the Ascension of our Lord and Redeemer, the day on which he brought to perfection his teaching of all provisions regarding Christian life, instituted the holy orders, ascended to God the Father who sent him, and sat at the right side of the power, the 10th day after the Feast of Ascension, and that day is the 15th day counting from the week of Easter, shall be among you a great feast, because on that day, at the third hour, our Lord Jesus Christus sent to us the Parcellet, the Spirit of Truth, and we were full of his will and spoke in new languages as the Spirit was moving into us. We preached to the Jews and the Gentiles that he was Christ God. After you finish celebrating the Feast of Pentecost, you shall celebrate for another 7 days to rejoice for God's gift, which has been granted to us. But one who fasts on Sunday, which is the day of resurrection, is a sinner and must be punished, as will be one who fasts during the Feast of Pentecost, or who is sad on our Lord's feast days, days in which we must rejoice with spiritual cheerfulness and not be sorrowful. Do not work during the week of Passion, nor during the following week, which is a great feast. During the first, because our Lord was crucified, and during the second, because he rose from death. Do not work on the feast days of Pentecost, because the decrees of God were fulfilled on that day. Again, do not work on the feast day of Pentecost, because the Holy Spirit, who descended upon those who believed in Christ, was manifested on that day. Do not work on Christmas, because on that day the grace of God was given to men. Do not work on the feast of baptism, because Christ revealed his divinity on that day. and because the Father witnessed his baptism, and the Holy Spirit descended upon him in the likeness of a dove, revealing to those who were present that Christ is truly God and the Son of God. Do not work on the feast day of the apostles, because they taught you to know Christ and made you worthy to share the gifts of the Holy Spirit. And in the chapter on alms, it is said that on feast days you must not appear naked before the Lord your God. The section on pilgrimages to venerated Jerusalem, home of the highest God, follows this. Anyone among you who has the opportunity to pray in the sanctuary of the city of God, where the holy steps are found, shall not hesitate to go for any reason which might prevent him from going, unless he is prevented by force. One must be eager to visit the place in which Christ our Lord suffered the pains in his body, and to see the place of his resurrection, and to gain benediction from those divine steps. One who is unable to go there shall send, according to his means, offerings to furnish the sanctuary and to support those who dwell there. Be they gold or silver, clothing or books, accepted as canonical by the church, or the like, the sanctuary of Jerusalem shall have a share in all estates left by members of the faithful who must look upon it and as of their heirs. For this is a commendable deed before God. Whoever does this will have grace in the holy city of God, and whatever he shall grant will be chosen and acceptable offering to God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Chapter 20, Martyrs, Confessors, and Apostates. Martyrs shall be honored among you, as the blessed James, Bishop of Jerusalem, and Saint Stephen, our companion and deacon, were honored among us. Martyrs are those who are blessed by God and whose eminence is not attainable. You shall not neglect a Christian brought to trial by the wicked for the sake of the name of our Lord, for the true faith, and for the love of God. And you shall send him what he needs, something out of what you gained with your true toil and with the sweat of your brow, so that he may find strength through it, and something to give as a reward to the soldiers who watch him, so that they may be good to him. He is a saintly martyr, brother of Christ, son of the highest, and dwelling of the Spirit of the Holy Spirit, witness to Christ's passion, companion in the example of his glory. Therefore, O faithful, let you also serve the saintly martyrs within your treasures and your toils. If any member of the faithful among you has nothing of his own to give, he shall fast for the saintly martyrs and shall set aside for their use half of his food. But he who is